We will begin the meeting, and we will start with roll call, starting with Mr. Wyatt.
Bob Wyatt.
Vicki McKinney.
Paula Rakestraw.
Kimberly McMichael.
Vicki Alston.
Doug Isley.
Brent Huss.
Thank you. Our announcements, the work session is scheduled for noon, Monday, September 26th. The meeting will be held at Dillard Academy, 810 Coeur Drive in Madison, North Carolina. The next board meeting is scheduled for 6 p.m. Monday, October 10th. The meeting will be held at Central Office here at 511 Harrington Highway in Eden. We will now move to our moment. I'm sorry, we are not moving to our moment of prayer. If you will please join me at this time for a moment of silence for our fifth grade student who passed away. She was a student at South End. She was tragically taken. If you would please join me in prayer for her family, her South End family, and her immediate family. Thank you. We will now move to our moment of prayer, led by Kevin Bedard, the youth pastor at Osborne Baptist Church.
Yeah. Let's pray. Father God, we come to you this evening so thankful for a beautiful day, and thank you for the gift of life. As we reflect on a young person that we lost today so tragically, I just pray for that family, God. Would you comfort them like only you can? Would you be with that South End family and teachers and administrators? And God, would your grace and mercy and comfort pour out on them like only you can? God, thank you for Rockingham County Schools, what it stands for, what it means, what it's here for. What a beacon of light in this community for the students and families to have fun, to be educated, to find hope, to find purpose, to find meaning, and to be educated in safe environments. God, I pray for our school board. God, thank you for each member in their heart for education and their heart for young people. I pray, as James 1 says, that if they need wisdom, that they seek it from you, and that you would give them wisdom in all decisions for all the best interest of all of our students and families in this beautiful county. God, thank you for our superintendent. I pray for him and his family, and I pray for him in his transition to his new position, and I pray that he knows that he is loved, and we are thankful that he is here. God, thank you for our families, every family that's represented in Rockingham County. What a beautiful place to raise a family, and God, I pray that the parents would know, and caregivers and guardians, whoever is raising the children, that they would know they're not alone, that they are the primary disciples and educators of their children, but we would walk alongside them and help them in that way and give them the tools and resources they need to. God, I thank you for each and every school in Rockingham County. Thank you for each principal and assistant principal and their staff, and from bus drivers to custodians to cafeteria workers to every person in the schools that you have gifted with talents and abilities to impact our young people. And I just pray that they know that they're loved and they're not alone. And God, as a father of a child in Rockingham County Schools, I pray that everyone that can hear my voice knows what a great privilege it is to have your children raised here. And we're thankful for our school system. And I pray for each and every administrator that they know they're not alone, and we support them. And God, especially as we end this prayer, September being Suicide Prevention Month, God, I pray for the mental health of our students. And I just pray that students would know that they're not alone, that there are adults that care for them, that love them, and that will stop whatever they're doing when things get too stressed or that they get too anxious. And God, I pray that they know that there's a whole county full of adults that would stop what they're doing to help them. And God, our help and healing and comfort comes from you. And God, I just thank you for the opportunity to be here tonight, and just thankful for your grace and mercy, just how you have, we see that everything comes from your good hand. And I pray that we would all seek you and know you and be thankful for the gift of your son, Jesus, who died for our sins on the cross. God, thank you, and I pray for everything over this meeting tonight, that it would be according to your will. And God, again, thank you for Rockingham County Schools and this school board. And as we celebrate the young people tonight at the meeting and talk about things that are need to be talked about, I pray that we would keep our eyes fixed on you and see that everything comes from you. God, we love you, and we trust you. It's in Christ's name I pray.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Would you please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance?
Ladies and gentlemen, if you will face the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you, Madam.
Thank you. We'll now entertain an approval of a motion to approve the agenda.
I would like to make a recommendation that we amend to remove 7.5.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
There's a motion and a second. Is there any other discussion?
Madam Chair.
Yes, sir.
I don't know if this is my mic on here. I apologize. Wanted to make, if I may make a friendly amendment, and I apologize, I didn't tell you, I wanted to pull out item 6.2 on a consent agenda, just for some brief discussion. Actually, did we figure that out, didn't we? I apologize, I withdraw it.
Okay.
So,
we have a motion and a second?
Yes, ma'am.
Is there any further discussion? If not, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. We will now move to the recognition of the McMichael High School STEM program. They participated in the TSA, which is Technology Student Association National Conference in Dallas, Texas, June 26th through the 30th of this year. The competition was held at Gaylord Texan Conference Center. Good tips. So, Mr. Stover, do you want to?
Yeah, I would like to ask two of the three advisors, Ms. Treadway and Mr. Butler, to come up, and they're going to have a presentation. I don't think that's me. We're going to be lucky enough to see some of their results in action. So I'm going to turn it over to Ms. Treadway and Mr. Butler. Mr. Butler is better half, is, I think, doing parent duties at her child's school. So she's not here, but I think we're well represented. I'll let you guys take it. Thank you. Thank you.
Board members, good to see y'all tonight, and Mr. Stover and audience, good to see all everybody here tonight. Ms. McMichael said, yes, we're the Technology Student Association students from McMichael High School, the Phoenix STEM Academy. So for those that don't know, TSA is a Career and Technical Education Association, similar to many people know about FFA. TSA is not as well known, but in this competition, students are able to compete in a variety of events, and all the students here with us today competed in events at the national level, but they all started at the regional level. So they all began going to Appalachian State University in February of last year, and then last school year, and then they went through the regional level with their events, and then they went to the state conference, which was in Greensboro at the Corey Convention Center for a three-day conference. They competed in a variety of events there. And then some did well and were able, and that's what these students here today, they were able to go to the national level and compete at the, in Dallas, Texas this year. And they did wonderful. Some of the events, like you don't know about the events, just a variety of events. Some are architectural related. We'll hear about that today. Some are doing speeches. Some are doing debating. Some are doing robotics. Anything technologically related. I would say altogether, there's probably about our students participated in probably about 15 events, roughly. Some they prepared before they went, and some of them they did on site. All right, so right now we had two student teams that made it to top 10 in the nation, and they brought some of their projects to showcase and talk about a little bit. And so the first one is our freshman group. Now they're in 10th grade now, but they were freshmen last school year. Our freshman group is going to come talk about their board game design. All right, guys, come on up.
And we appropriately have a card table laid out.
All right, so I'm Mason Zhang, and I'm one of the members of the team.
I'm Dylan Knight, and I'm also a team member.
I'm Jose Carrera, and I am also a team member.
So this is our project that we made for TSA. This project has gone through many phases, many forms. We've been working on this for a very long time, ever since like November of last year. So it's been a very long and like long journey and a lot of process we had to go through, many changes. So would you like to talk about some of the earlier phases of our project?
Yes, one of the earlier phases of our project was actually designing three different games. One of them was the King of Games. It was meant to be a kind of like game where it was like a bunch of different mini games. And, you know, it was similar to a game called Mario Party, which you would do similarly the same thing. Another game that we had was Coast to Coast. You would have to go to one part of the United States to the other coast. And then we had Island Defense, which is now known as Moon Rats. It was later then evolved to interests that we like rats and space.
So earlier on in the project, this was originally a school project that we later be able to take to to TSA. So we had to first of all get like one of our ideas approved of, right? So originally this was Island Defense before, and we changed it, you know, to make it more interesting. So there's a lot of like, you know, things we realized problems and for things we didn't like, and we'll morph our game to, you know, end up being better. And there was many hardships through the way. We had many things that didn't work, like some pieces might not be printed well. There was a lot of trial and error in our game. But it was a really nice process to make this. So we also got a lot of feedback from our classmates. And one of the first things that we did is build a mock-up of this game. And then the mock-up, we basically let our classmates test it. And our first mock-up, no one could figure out how to play with our current rules at the time. But, you know, later on, as we've evolved the game and improved it over time and just gotten feedback, we were able to make the rules much more readable. And, you know, so someone can, like, pick up the rules and then play the game without needing, like, you know, someone there explaining to them. So would you like to talk about regional?
Regional was the first competition we went to. We placed eighth, was it?
It was around there.
Yeah, it was eighth place, which was pretty low. Actually, considering it was the first level. So, like, obviously, we didn't do the best. And so then we decided, hey, let's try it again at state. We went to state, we got, like, the same place, but we still kept going. But we did see improvement a lot.
Could I talk about national?
Yeah.
And then we went to national, which was the highest level. And we decided, hey, let's try it again. But we changed so much, we worked so hard. We spent like a week more, like after school ended, just to make the game even more better. And we managed to get 10th place, which was really good for like, considering it was all of the United States. Exactly. And like some, like two other countries, which I forgot the name of. I don't know if those are important or not.
Oh, and also we're going to talk about, so we had another team member join us, which is Dylan Knight, and he's going to talk about some of his involvement in the game before National.
Nationals is really where I come in because I didn't join the team until, sometime before Nationals, both of them were like, hey, we're doing Nationals. You want to join the team? And I was like, sure, and... And Jose originally did the art, but I redid all of the art. And we just worked on the game, like they said, for a week more after school. And then we went to Dallas, Texas, and we got up 10th place. So.
Very good.
Yeah.
So we're going to actually discuss some of our game now and how it's actually played. So you get an idea of what the game actually is. And basically, the easiest way to sum it up is kind of like a defense kind of game where you're supposed to take out the other opponents and be, you know, as the game says, the last rat standing, which you can see on the cover of the box. And that's just kind of the tagline that we had for the game. So we're going to go into more detail on kind of how the game is played, just kind of give you like a rough idea. And So basically, the game starts out with, you know, four bases, right? It can be 2 to 4 players. So there's a lot of like opportunities for, you know, if, for example, you don't have enough people, you can play with 3 people or 2 people, whatever is needed at the time. And so first you start out with only 1 rat attacker. And you basically, the main goal in the beginning is to get to the main like center point, which is the shopkeeper. Here's like one of the most important elements of the game. It can be kind of a control point you kind of want to get to, because what you can do with the shopkeeper is buy traps and stuff like that to help defend the game and defend your base and stuff like that. There's a lot of like strategy involved in this game. Originally, when we were making the board game, we had to think, are we going to have this be a game of strategy, chance, or skill? And we wanted to do a strategy game since, you know, it'd be kind of nice to have a game where there's a lot of thought involved. So we kind of built the game around that. And do you want to talk more about how the game is played?
Sure. There you go.
Could you put that up, please?
Okay.
Hey, these are like little mini cheese pieces.
To start the game off, you can choose to do one of 2 things. Mine for cheese. I don't like that. But you can choose to mine for cheese or make a decision. Recommended, doesn't really matter. You can actually choose what you want. I actually say recommended. If you roll for a decision, there are multiple things you can do. Once you roll, depending on what the dice says, that's how many decisions you have. With those decisions, you can place half tiles. These half tiles will help you get to anywhere you want, because you cannot land on any of these gray spaces unless there is a path tile already placed. Another thing you can do with your decisions is, if you have a trap, any of these traps, you can place it down using one of those decisions. And in order to get these traps, you have to go to the shopkeeper and buy them. In order to buy them, you need cheese. And so you have to mine for this cheese. You roll this, keep dropping everything, that was fun. You roll this dice, and whatever the number is at the top, that is how much cheese you get. So that's 1, and the other one is 4. So that would be 5 cheese. That would be 5 cheese. And the prices are listed here on the rules. Mason, could you show this, please?
It's hard to see it.
I don't know if you can tell how passionate they are about their project. They know the ins and outs of this thing. I think they're also leaving out how they actually created every piece of this from scratch, 3D printed, laser printed. They designed and drew every bit of it. I think they deserve a huge round of applause, and thank you guys for letting them take up some time and present tonight. Great job.
I've won the most.
No competition there, it sounds.
As they're getting that ready to go, we got another one of our top 10. She's actually top 10 in 2 competitions. So the Kyle, if you can come on up while they're finishing their picture and game there.
Hold your box to the front of the box.
Yeah, hold it. Yeah, there you go.
The front. Yeah. There you go.
Thank you. Great job.
Another thing I want to add is I want to thank the school system for letting us do this. It's a really great opportunity.
Hi everyone, I'm Kylie. I participated in 3 events at TSA, a web design event, and then 2 architecture related events. And those architecture related events are the ones that I placed in top 10 at nationals. So one of the event I did on site is called CAD Architectural, and essentially what they do is they give you a prompt, like design a house, just like a design a tiny house, design a house for a family of 4, and then certain specifications, and you're given typically 4 hours to do this, and then you just have to, you get 1 program, and you get to do it on site, no research, nothing, you just make it in those 4 hours. So I competed in this event at regionals, states, and nationals. And at regionals, I, like them, did not do so great. I didn't even get top 3. But it was really great to actually get a lower place at regionals because the feedback that the judges give you is really helpful in learning how to better yourself. And I really appreciated that. And so with that feedback, I was able to go to states and then learn from my mistakes and place first at states. So that was really great. And so then when we went to nationals, the prompt at nationals was to essentially design a tiny home for an elderly family member for them to live like on the back of your property, which I thought was really a fun challenge because I've always been interested in tiny homes. And I'm actually quite interested in accessibility in architecture. And so that was a really great project to combine tiny homes with accessibility, not something you usually think of that goes together. So it was a really fun challenge. And so I had a lot of fun. I designed kind of a Victorian style house to kind of, you know, make them maybe think of houses they might have seen more when, you know, they were growing up or they were, you know, younger adults rather than more modern buildings, make them feel more at home. And so with that, I placed eighth in the nation. And I really love the experience because once again, you get so much feedback and already from that, I've learned so much with how to use the program Revit, which we use to design these houses.
Very good.
This is my architectural design project, which is very similar, except for you have to design beforehand and bring it to the competition. So the prompt for this category this year was to design employee housing for a national park. So I chose Acadia National Park in Maine because you could pick whatever you wanted. And I chose that because I was reading about them and they have absolutely horrible housing. So it's like, it's a fake project, but you know, try to make it better where you can. And so this project started out as a class assignment. It was kind of learning how to use the programs while you were designing it. So when we first started out, we used the program AutoCAD to design the floor plans. And then we would transfer that into this software, Revit, which you use to essentially make the 3D version of the house, the floor plans, the more official version of it. And so that is the program I used to make this rendering of the model here. And you can show it to them. And then with Revit, you can also make these floor plans of each level of the houses, and that's what we have here. We have a level of the upstairs and then the downstairs. With this project, I also did not place at regionals. And so that showed me where I needed to improve, and I realized a lot of different things that I could do better. And so this is actually the floor plans of what I took to regionals. So I took these and then I improved upon them. And then at states, I was able to get a second, which was really rewarding because it was a lot of work to redo it because I had to redo the entire model. We make a 3D model of the entire building. It had originally my one at regionals had, it was just nothing on the inside, just a building with like, you know, just looked like essentially that picture of that. But the one I went for states, you know, redid the whole thing, made it bigger, made it look nicer, did a better site, and had it like the roof come off and each level of the floors show. And so that was really fun to redo. And then for nationals, you just turned it at nationals, and I was very nervous. I didn't even think I'd place, but I placed the top 24 in the preliminary round, but I was able to get ninth at nationals, which was great. Really rewarding because I was a little afraid because most people who do this are in teams, and I was just doing it by myself, so I was really proud of that. I would just like to thank Rockingham County Schools for funding a very large portion of this trip. It's something we probably never could have done without funding, and it was such a great experience. I learned so many skills, not only in these softwares, but like the communication skills, presentation giving skills, and in the STEM program in general. Freshman year, I would have been up here crying probably. So I just think it's a great experience to not only learn these programs and these like hard skills, but the soft skills you learn are almost just as important. And I really appreciate that. So thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Stover?
Mr. Wyatt? We, first of all, one of the keys to a great student design, great work design, are do the students persist in the face of difficulty? And I think we have two good examples here of students who are persisting in the face of difficulty and not giving up. And I think it shows what is possible in Rockingham County and Little Rockingham County. Our kids can compete with the best. It just takes persistence, great instructors, and support, and we have all three of those things here. And also, Ms. Young, I think we need to let SKA know about our designers, and then hopefully she can, you can design one of our new schools whenever that happens. Okay?
So what we have here is, I'm going to call your name. We have some recognitions for the kids. I'm going to call a name, and Mr. White is going to hand you the certificate and shake and just show our appreciation.
And let me say, this program has a day and night at McMichael where all of the students show what they have done. And the freshmen will do one thing, sophomores one, juniors and seniors, correct? And they do a lot of team building. A lot of the projects are team oriented. And my grandson was in school with some of these youngsters. He's at School of Math and Science now, but when he was at McMichael, I would take him to McMichael on Saturday morning, correct, Mr. Butler? And you would be sitting in the floor putting together the robotics items, whatever they were, and this doesn't just happen. I will tell you that it takes leadership and it takes commitment on the part of the students. And the instructors, the butlers, the instructors at McMichael are second to none. Appreciate, and I've told these youngsters already, and I appreciate what they have done.
Thank you. And so, first of all, if you'll just come up here, we'll, Mr. Wyatt will give you a certificate, and you'll stay up here, and we'll get a quick picture with the board members as well. How's that sound? Okay, so we have Mason Zhang, who for participation and also for being in the top 10. So you get two.
Let me get Mason.
Jose Pereira, who also for participation and placing in the top 10. Congratulations.
Good job.
Dylan Knight.
The artist. Good job.
And Kylie Belter. Who's going to be our next grade class? I should have handed it to Mr.
Good job.
Okay, and we'd also like to recognize the following. If you're here, just come up. Todd Dorbach.
And let's just slide around here.
Madison Rutledge.
Full picture.
I don't think she's here today.
Okay.
Roman Goins.
Roman's here.
Yeah.
Hey, Roman. Mm-hmm. Slide around on the other side and the picture. Okay.
Autumn Hamby. Lee Simmons. Some of our kids have graduated and they're on to better things, but we still wanted to recognize them. Treasure Akins. Kylie Belcher, here's the other one that I was trying to find.
Kylie. All right.
Shelby Parker. Joshua Griffin. Brian Aguirre. And Enrique Gonzalez. And we'd also like to recognize our advisors.
Exactly.
So Ms. Treadway. And Mr. Butler. And I have one for
one.
Thank you. Okay. All right, board members, do you want to come down with for the picture as well, or are we good?
I'll take it. We'll stay.
I won't.
Since it is a school night tonight, and you have, I'm sure you have lots of studying and some STEM homework to do, you're also free to go as well.
Thank you for being here.
So, Ms. Rakestraw, could you now read the statement to move us into public comments, please?
In accordance with School Board Policy 2310, we will now turn to the public comments section of our meeting. On behalf of the Board of Education, I'd like to express our gratitude for your contributions to our discussion of issues facing our board and our schools. Public comments do not necessarily reflect the views of the board. Board members will not respond directly to individuals who address the board during this portion of the meeting, except to request clarification of points made by the presenter. Out of respect for the privacy of our students and staff, discussion of matters involving individual students or personnel will not be permitted. All speakers will be allowed 3 minutes for their comments, and we ask that you please conclude your comments when you hear the second beep. The board will allow up to 1 hour for public comment. In the event that all speakers cannot be heard during the 1 hour designated, the board will allow time following the conclusion of its business for the remaining comments. Thank you to each of you who signed up for public comment.
Thank you. Our first speaker is Ms. Yamaguchi.
Hello, I am Neo Shoti Yamaguchi, 2065 Turner Road, Reidsville, North Carolina. I want to first thank you, all board members. I've been seeing you a lot more, Mr. Stover. I've been seeing you at schools. It's great. When we see you, it means that you care. Not just for the people in this building, but for everyone out there. Just like Pastor Kevin Bedard said, it matters from the down up. Custodians, bus drivers, everybody matters. So seeing you in things that we're doing in the community, seeing you at events, seeing you at sporting events, it's great to see your presence. I know I always see Ms. Rakestraw, and she always makes a point to make sure to say hi to me every time, and I appreciate that a lot. So some of the things that I want to mention is those people from the down up. Bus driver pay incentives have now been kind of diminished because of the COVID funds. What are we gonna do about it? There's bonuses and incentives from counties right around us to come work here, but we don't really have any. I mean, Guilford County offered $10,000 for people to go teach there, and boy, did we lose quite a bit. I'm scared that the end of this month, we're also going to lose quite a bit. What are we doing as a county to try to improve that? Some of the things you might be hearing about also is coming from the Professional Educator Preparation and Standards Commission. They've created a proposal for teacher entrance. We know there's a teacher shortage, but this proposal is actually going to make it worse. They're trying to get teachers measured by their effectiveness, seeing EOC scores, seeing evaluations. Our school alone raised our math scores 10%, but that still wasn't enough. So what are we going to do as a county to try to help bring in those teachers despite what the state is trying to do? And I will definitely be sharing more information when I get that for you guys. But I want to make sure that you're aware of all of the situations and things that are affecting us as educators, because we've got to set up a plan. Not in June, we've got to set it up now. I also want to mention that I am super excited because at the end of this week, September 15th through October 15th, is Hispanic Heritage Month. And I hope to see different schools and different counties doing stuff. Be prepared to see messages from Reidsville, because we have a bunch of events coming up. for the students to participate in. And it's really just a thing about representation. And as some of you already know, I'm all about representation and making sure that everybody is represented. So thank you so much, and I appreciate you.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you for being here. We will now move to the board comment, board member comment portion of our meeting. Yes, sir.
It was good to see the older kids, but all of our babies start off in kindergarten, and everybody here has had one that had to start school, first grade, kindergarten. So let me tell you about my young friend. He has just started kindergarten. This is for real. His mom is a teacher. His dad is a sports writer. His baby sister is annoying. His mom and dad read to him every night at bedtime, and he wants to learn to read. After open house, his mom sent me a text. And I won't say the name, but she says, here he is at open house. He was excited but shy, definitely giving his teacher a false sense of security. I texted back, said he will soon think that his teacher hung the moon. And mom texted back, said he already talks about her like she's the best thing since sliced bread. He's very excited. I'm pretty sure kindergarten teachers are fairy princesses. All the ones I have met have been amazing. So, mom is a teacher. She doesn't get to go with him to school the first day. So, poor dad. So, after dad took him to school, he put on his Facebook, he said, I woke to a sound. It was not the baby. It was not the door. It was my son standing over me, dressed with his book bag on, saying, Dad, we are going to be late. He was ready, but I don't know if I was. I think the first day preps of preschool have led to this. We were second in the car line, and when he got out of the car, he ran past the first kid and was the first one in the building. Look out, kindergarten, here he comes. Okay, this youngster is ready for school. He is ready for school. But we realize that all students aren't prepared for learning, as this young friend. Not only are our students not equally prepared, our facilities are not equally prepared. Our facilities have many discrepancies, as many as our young students. Thanks to our staff for meeting the many obstacles that they meet in providing a positive educational experience for all of our students. Thank you.
Yeah. I don't think so either.
Thank you, Madam Chair. First of all, I'd just like to say to all our staff, minus a few hiccups in the giddy alone, we had a great start to this year. Knock on wood. It's been amazing to watch everybody work together. I've had the opportunity not to go to every school, but I went to about 14 schools so far and talked to staff and went to different departments. And I don't know, it's something different. And minus just a few little hiccups, things got off to a great start. Seeing this presentation, and I appreciate Ms. Young, everybody in CTE, and all the departments that helped get the kids to Texas. That is awesome, hands-on. And the kids are engaged and involved, and even though they were talking about, they're sitting there talking about how their placement was bad, no, they were there. They were there, and despite things that they had going against them, they turned around and made it work. And my hat's off to the staff about that, my hat's off to the kids, and I just pray that this school system, we can continue to provide programs that will guide our kids to a pathway of an education, whether it be college, whether it be landscaping, veterinarian, doctor, whatever. We need to give them all an opportunity. And I just want to thank staff. Thank you, Superintendent, as well. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Okay. I'd like to thank all the students that were here tonight. They were just knocked it out of the ballpark. It was fantastic, every one of them. And also, we need to congratulate our Teacher of the Year. We did that after our last board meeting. Becca Isley from Monroton School and Justin Cunningham of Reedsville Middle School was the beginning Teacher of the Year. So we're very proud of both of those. And congratulations to all four high school tennis teams. But Reedsville High School is our 2022 RCS Girls Tennis Team Champions. Good. And we're very proud of Reedsville. Thank you.
Well, I think it's been a great start to the year too, Bob. I love that. That was precious. But and I was really excited to see the students here. That's always great. Thank y'all for having them here. And I did want to say the Rockingham County Education Foundation is doing, were you going to say something about it? Is doing the teachers on trails on Wednesdays. That's been that was a lot of fun. It was hot last week, but it was a lot of fun. So if you have the opportunity to join folks on Wednesday, I think it's at 5 o'clock. At different trails throughout the county, so I think you could check their website and or Facebook page, and they'll have that up. But anyway, it has been, Mr. Isley, you're right. It is different. We don't have masks. We're able to see smiling faces this year. We are able to hear those voices when they get out of the car and do those things. So it is different this year. It's nice for it to be different.
So I'd like to echo the thank you for the McMichael STEM students being here. And I'd also like to thank our law enforcement. That first day that we went back to school, I sat at a stoplight for 9 changes of red and green before I was able to turn left. But our law enforcement has really been quite helpful in making sure that traffic flowed appropriately around our schools. And I just want to say thank you to them for that. And thank you to our SROs. I know we've seen them, you know, at every event throughout the day. And I just appreciate our staff and our administrators and all of the preparation that went into a smooth return to school. Also, if you are able, I know that the backpack programs, I'm sure, are continuing this year. And we have all seen shortages of things in the grocery stores. And so that means that our students have some needs at home. And so if you're able, they always love things like individually packed peanut butters and granola bars and little packets of oatmeal, that kind of thing. Anything that a child can prepare for themselves would be a great contribution for you to give to school. It does appear that our classrooms have been very well supplied with things like Kleenexes and the sanitization wipes and all of those kinds of things. So thank you to the parents who have made those contributions. And my last plug is, this is a great time of year. If you're going to order a yearbook, most of our schools have some sort of an offer for a discount. There's a window that the yearbooks are a little less. So if your budget allows, this is still the window of opportunity for you to make that purchase. And I just appreciate everything that's gone into the school year return. And so that's it. Anything else? Anybody else? No? Okay. Well, we will move right into our consent agenda. Is there a motion to approve the consent agenda?
Madam Chair, I move we approve the consent agenda.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. Is there any discussion? There's no discussion. There's a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Move right on to our action items. Our first one is the approval of the child nutrition procurement. Dr. Moyer.
Good evening, Mr. Stover and board members. Tonight I present to you the procurement plan, and this is to assist us with purchasing goods and services to help support the goal of school nutrition, to provide the safe and nutritious school food for the children and allow us to do various purchasing that's needed for the department. if it hits that threshold of 75,000, you know, we will talk to Mr. Stover, Ms. Young, Finance, and everybody and present it to you all so that we can make those purchases. But this aligns with DPI and their procurement processes. So this is why we come to you this evening for the presentation of this.
Thank you. Is there a motion to approve?
I make the motion to approve.
Thank you.
Nutrition plan.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. Is there any discussion? If there's no discussion, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mann. 7.2, the approval of our establishment of the Finance Committee. Ms. Ellis, Mr. Stover.
So, as you know, we presented the establishment of the Finance Committee at our last. And technology apparently it might be contagious, so be careful. We presented it with the recommendations, and then the board asked us to research a community member, and after doing some research and talking to staff and consulting with our attorney, we think it's better that we don't, because these are open meetings in the first place, and any member of the public is invited to attend, and sure, we would love to have members of the public attend, because I think it's very important. We have a large budget, and I think it's important that we're very transparent with our budget. And so with that, we are going to recommend that you accept the Finance Committee as recommended in the board, our work session, and not with the establishment of a community member, for various reasons, which I articulated. Also, none of our other committees have a community member, and so we think it would be fair just to keep everything consistent with our other committees. And so that is what we're recommending. Do we have any questions?
I do.
Yes.
So if we are just going back to a regular committee, that means we really don't need to vote for this, correct?
I don't think we actually voted for it last time, because we were going
we
to,
did.
To...
We don't have to vote for it, right?
We don't.
No.
Great. So we just want to.
Because policy dictates, right, policy that we just that get to establish it.
That's right.
Okay. Perfect. Okay. But you know what? Thank you so much for that explanation, since it was on our work session.
Yeah, that's right. Thank you.
I appreciate
you.
That.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Is that good? Any questions? All right. So moving right along to 7.3, Dr. Corcoran.
Good evening, Superintendent Stover, Madam Chair, and board members. I'm here tonight to talk with you and present contracts that Head Start would like your approval on. And I have Ms. Jumper here, who is our Director of Head Start. And so she's going to walk you through these. I'll step aside and let you do that.
Thank you.
Glasses.
Good evening, Mr. Stoffel, Madam Chair, board members. Thank you for allowing Head Start to stand before you and ask for approval of these contracts. So the first contract that we have is for consultation services and support for the monitoring review and all of. Since I am a new Head Start director, and since I'm a new Head Start director and Head Start is new to the school system, we're getting ready for the focus area 2 monitoring review. We saw fit to contract with she's a federal reviewer. Her name is Rashad Rodas, but she's not for our region, because that would be a conflict of interest. But she has really helped us. She helped some last year. She's really helped us follow, you know, the guidelines, making sure that, you know, the fiscal part is correct, making sure that our policies and procedures are aligned with the Head Start performance standards. And with, you know, being new, we want to make sure that we are not found out of compliance or deficient. If that happens, they could bring the grant up to competition. And that means the area, counties, or anyone could come up for, could apply for that grant during our five-year cycle, and we do not want that to happen. So in order for us to make sure that we are where we need to be and doing all the things and following the Head Start performance standards, then we feel that it is necessary to contract with someone who has been in the field over 30 years. Mm-hmm. Are there any questions? Okay. Okay. So the next, I'm not sure which one you have next.
Where do you want me?
In the contracts, yes. We have.
If you'll scroll down, you might be able to.
Okay, so the next contract that we have for approval is the contract for the class. Okay, so the next contract is for, we do, as you know, well, you might not know, we do not have a, at this time, an education manager. Our education manager resigned. And so being in that the vacant spot, we see fit to contract with Dr. Susan Connolly, who is the program director of the birth through kindergarten early childhood program and the PAL program, which she's in charge of licensing, to come into our program and work with our teachers. With our teachers being from the county, there were years that they, you know, coming into the school system, they have to learn, you know, school system standards, the alignments. And so we want to have someone, because where we want them to go at this time, for our five-year strategic plan, we want all of our classrooms blended. In order to do that, all of our teachers need to be licensed. Being licensed is not currently required by Head Start, but because now we're under LEA, we want them to come to the same quality as the preschool teachers. With that being said, we want them, they have to have coaching, they have to have someone in their classroom to help them with the systems and the routines, because you know, as Mr. White was saying, our students come in, the demographic that we work with, they come in at a deficit, they come in at risk. So it's very important for all of these teachers to have high quality skills and strategies to work with these students and families. We not only work with students, we work with families. And so we felt that in the absence of the education manager, that we needed this person to come in and be hands-on with our teachers. We have new teachers. Like I said, we have teachers that are in school getting their license. So we felt that this would be better for our program. And also, going through our monitoring review, that she will be there to help us, you know, help the teachers guide through that. And she's had experience. She's worked with Gift for Child Development. She's worked with other Head Start programs. And she's very, you know, aware of the all of the Head Start standards and being in a review. So we felt like she was the best person for this, you know, the contract. Are there any questions?
I have one.
Yes, ma'am.
Are all of your teachers for Head Start, are they certified, or I guess when I say certified, do they hold a degree in teaching?
Well, all of our teachers hold a associate degree.
Okay.
Now, we have three teachers who are currently licensed. We have several of our teachers who have bachelor degrees. And then we have some that we were looking to hire licensed teachers, but because of the, you know, not being sure of our budget and how things were going to go, we kind of played that kind of, you know, safe the first year or two. Mm-hmm. Now that we're getting further in it, and we've talked, you know, had some experience with the program specialists and the grant specialists, we're moving toward. So all of our teachers are the ones who do not have a teacher license. They are presently in school.
So actually the coach that yes. you're talking about will work with those kids
yes.
that, I mean, teachers that are not mm-hmm. certified.
Right, yes, ma'am.
Okay.
And if you recall, the board voted, I don't think it was the last board meeting, but maybe the board meeting before last, to provide that performance incentive, which is that they would go to school, that we would offer an incentive for any of our Head Start teachers who were going back to school. We would help with like books and things like that mm-hmm. to try to incentivize them to reach that level of expertise.
Right, right. Thank you, Ms. Johnson.
And we have two teachers who are currently in the spring. They should have their license. And then the rest of the teachers within the next 2 years will be licensed.
That's good. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes.
So it's basically the supportive roles that these positions will be, right?
Yes.
How much time will we get for the compensation we're giving them for that? How much time will they spend with us?
How much time will Dr. Conley be able to?
Oh, she will be, it's in the contract. She's going to be here for the whole school year, and she will be in the classrooms, every classroom with every teacher, at least 12 hours.
Okay.
During the month and during the, and then 10 months, as long as the teachers are in. So this is for the whole year.
Okay. Thank you.
Did I answer? I hope I
answered. Yes, ma'am. Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Any more questions? Okay. And so the next, yes, Ms. We have two proposals. The first proposal is for Dr. Michelle Lesprince. She is a health and wellness coach. And these will be using COVID funds because, and I have these, I don't know if, let's see. What I'm giving you is the notice from the Head Start, Office of Head Start on the allowable uses of the COVID funds. Mm. And if you look on the last page, the fourth page, I highlighted for you about staff and wellness. They were asking us because we know that, as I said before, that our staff work with the most, you know, at-risk population. These children come in and the families come in with life stressors. They is something called compassion fatigue. And what we know is when these children come into these classrooms and these teachers are taking on those situations while the children are in the classroom. Also, they go home to their own life stressors. This is heavy. That attributes to teacher burnout. It attributes to teachers leaving the field. And we really care about our teachers. We care about their well-being. We want them to be able to deal with stress, deal with their health issues. So Dr. Michelle Lesprince will work with them on stress management, health and wellness, and, you know, helping these teachers to be able to deal with some of the things that they're dealing with so they can have a productive, you know, be productive in the classroom, working with the teachers, working with these children and working with the families, the teachers, all of this that's coming down on our teachers. So what we're asking is for you to approve her contract. She will be working for this is a whole entire year. She does individual sessions and group sessions. It is dependent on what the person requests or needs, because some things are private and they don't want to be in a group, so they'll talk about them privately. So she has, you know, worked with our staff, you know, in the past. She was at pre-service training and did a lot of training on, you know, dealing with stress, you know, just, you know, dealing with just stress. I'm sorry, and then the health issues, because we know that stress does affect the health of our staff. So are there any questions?
Then if you'll just include the other.
Yes.
There's also one for families, mm-hmm. in which she is, yes, willing to work with families as well.
Yes, and that is a pro bono in kind. So that is worth $4,800 that she is just donating to our families. And then she will introduce the same thing, helping families deal with their stressors, you know, things that are, you know, stress management, anger management, dealing with, you know, time and anything that the family might share with her that they feel like that they would need someone to talk to, and, you know, just consultations and that. So that she is gifting us that, but we still have to have your approval for her to come in and work with the families and the staff.
Are there any questions?
I have a couple of comments if you don't mind. One is, I want to thank you, Ms. Jumper, and Dr. Corcoran, for the work that y'all are doing with this program. You are really setting this program up for success, because you are the work that your staff is doing and the work that they're doing with folks like Dr. Connolly is just improving the quality of care that these children are getting, and they will be our children in our kindergarten classrooms. Mm-hmm. And I continue to say that Head Start is a venue for us to close that disproportionate yes. learning gap that we see so much of. And so and so many people in our community don't understand, or maybe they haven't heard about the requirements that families have to have with Head Start. If your child is in a Head Start program, you know volunteering in the classroom mm-hmm. is one of the things. There's a policy council, as you all know, that I serve as a liaison mm-hmm. to the board for that, and we have parents who not only serve on that policy council but are leading that mm-hmm. policy council and have been recognized at the mm-hmm. state level. Yes. And so we're building a community of families that is invested in their children's education. And that's what we want. That's exactly what we've been right. asking for. So I just want to thank you all for the work that you're doing. And the work that, and I can't remember how to pronounce her name, but Michelle.
Lesprince.
Mm-hmm. Okay. She worked with you all last year, yes. and you all did a sort of like a pre and post and saw mm-hmm. improvement on absenteeism
yes.
and things such as that. So I think that's better added benefit yes. to it. So kudos to y'all. I'm so proud of our early childhood babies and families.
And then the last information that we want to share that we need your approval. Now, I just want to say, I think it was, I need to make clear that the mask mandate for when the school system, oh, they have to vote on this first. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. Okay.
She's ready to be done.
So, are there any more questions? So, here's the IRB. Sorry for been scrolling through this.
Madam Chair.
Yes, sir.
I will make the motion that we approve those contracts.
Thank you, Mr. Wyatt. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. There's a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. Thank you.
We will now talk about that.
Thank you. So as you know, that last year when the school board voted for masks to be optional in the Rockingham County schools, Head Start did not fall under that because Head Start is a federally funded program and we have to follow the federal guidelines. The federal guidelines were very adamant and they were very strict about wearing the mask, the staff and children wearing their masks. So in August, we received an email. It was a bulletin from the Office of Head Start, and then I have this if you want to look at it, and it was highlighted. What it's saying is that they're now turning the option over to the Head Start, individual Head Start programs. Now, we're not voting, you're not like actually voting, but what we're talking about is the policy. So what they asked us to do is to create a policy within our program on how we're going to move forward. It also says in there that to follow the guidelines of the CDC, and what that is, the CDC is saying that when the COVID is high in the community, then we need to wear masks indoors, you know. So we have created the policy that you have in front of you, and what it's saying is that we will make masks optional with the understanding that if the 15% in a classroom, which that's about three children in a classroom, children or staff, come down with COVID, then we will re-implement the mask. But we also have something on there for the parents and families, the staff and families to sign, that they understand that there is a chance that we might have to implement the mask again if the cases of COVID start to rise.
And families are aware that this is a federal yes. program,
not a state
program. We don't have, right.
Yeah, yes, ma'am.
So with that said, is there a motion to approve the optional mask policy revision for Head Start?
I make the motion to approve optional mask for Head Start.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Have a good evening.
You too. We will now move to 7.6, our superintendent report.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I only have a few things, and some of them were mentioned. First of all, on August 29th, we opened up our schools, our final 20 schools. And what was most remarkable about our opening is how unremarkable it was. And that unremarkability, I'm not sure if that's quite a word, but it is now. That unremarkability was a result of a lot of hard work from our teachers, our staff members, our custodians, our bus drivers. Just think about it. We had to get, over 10,000 kids fed to school. We had to deal with traffic. We did have some hiccups, but those were addressed immediately and improved. And I just want to thank the staff for doing that. We went and prepared. We had some metrics that we presented to you the last work session. We think those had a lot to do with contributing to our smooth opening. But more than anything, it was the folks that we have that contributed to it. And so I'm happy to say that it was very blah. I like blah. I like blah. Even though it is chocolate milkshake day, apparently, as well, which I was not planning to be on my board report, but I'm just saying that because I said it. We also like to call your attention that the state accountability results were released on September 1st, and we're going to have a full and detailed report for the board at our next work session, where we're going to show, what happened with our report, with the current 80-20 model that has lots of questions all over the state, and what would happen if we actually did a 50-50 model, for example. But one of the highlights I want to let the board know is that 18 of our 21 schools met the growth metric, which is very important. It's the thing that I look at first and foremost. And 9 of our schools exceeded their growth metric, which is the largest number of schools that we've had in Rockingham County exceed the growth metric. So very happy about that.
Good job.
Again, we'll have a very in-depth report for you. I got a quick preview of it right before our meeting. We're excited to dig into that and look at where we can leverage our strengths and where we need to improve as a district. And then finally, thank you, Madam Chair, for the moment of silence for our fifth grade student at Reedsville. That was a challenging, Thursday was challenging. Actually, last week was challenging in a number of different ways. And again, I want to recognize our staff because it was challenging. And these are the types of events when we lose a child. When you have an incident that can test partner relations, they can quickly spin out of control, and we didn't let that happen. We had our staff was our crisis team was on point and available at Reedsville Middle School to support our fourth grade teachers came in, were part of it, and we were able to address and give the kids and the staff members the time they needed to grieve, which is so important. And while we're very sad, I'm going to focus on one thing. I'm going to focus on the student, all that I heard about her. The one thing I heard consistently was that her smile lit up the room. And that she was a pleasure to teach. And though we only had her for 2 years, fourth grade and into fifth grade, she made an impact on the staff. And, as Billy Joel said, only the good die young. And she was obviously one of the good ones, and it was tragic, but I'm gonna focus on the light she brought us while she was here. So that is all I have for you. Thank you.
Thank you. I just wanna reiterate through my comments that how much we appreciate Dr. Ellis and her crisis team and all of their leadership and how they show up and support our kids and our staff. We really appreciate your leadership and Dr. Corcoran's leadership and the way you love on our staff and students. So thank you for all that you do. So at this time, could I get a motion to go into closed session?
Madam Chair, I move that according to General Statute 143.318.11, we go into closed session to preserve confidentiality, attorney-client privilege, and to discuss personnel considerations.
Thank you. Is there a second?
I'll second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Guys, let's take a 10-minute recess, please, and turn off your microphones.
Aye.
Thank you. Is there a motion to approve the personnel report as amended?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Madam Chair.
Yes, sir.
I'm going to recuse myself from voting on the personnel report.
Thank you. Is there any discussion? We have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. Thank you. So I have a statement to read. In the case of Shotwell versus Rockingham County Schools Board of Education, a settlement agreement for a total of $120,000, including back pay and other non-monetary terms, has been reached. At this time, can I have a motion for an adjournment?
Madam Chair, I move that we adjourn.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. All in favor, stand up.